Good morning. Welcome to our gift day service. I can see there's a lot of gifts already. If you've got some gifts, would you mind bringing them now? That would be kind. And put them under the Christmas tree. Thank you. I know that many of you have already done that. I was about to say that there is some style in the church today. And most of the style are from those who are under 10, I have to be honest. And there's more gifts coming. We've got Dorothy from the Wizard of Oz here today. Where do you see these shoes? Where do you see these shoes? Whoa, just like Dorothy. And look at that lovely Christmas tree. Good, good, thank you. Paddy would love a pair of shoes like those. Thank you very much. They look good. It's great to have the late Mr. Jim Phillips here with us today. Not at all. Oh, those are lovely. Those are lovely shoes. Okay, thanks for coming today, and thank you so much for the gifts. They will be given out to those who need them most. Can I remind you that we have Cafe Church tonight? The reason I want to remind you of that is it'll be Christmas songs tonight and a wee Christmas message. If you have family or friends that you can invite along, please do that. The service is only half an hour. If you want to bring your children, feel free to do that. It's very relaxed and it'd be great to see you out. It's 6:30 for half an hour tonight. A couple other announcements. And the congregational Christmas card is at the back of the church. Anyone want to sign it and give a donation, all will be given to Marie Curie. So we thought that would be an idea that rather than all Christmas cards going about, if you want to sign the congregational Christmas card and the gifts that you would give would be how much you would normally pay for cards or postage, that would be very kind. Also, there's carol singing at the Fold, and that's Inverary Fold, on Tuesday the 13th at 7:45. We're asking for the Fold team to go along to that with the PW. But anyone else is welcome to come along to sing carols. Thinking of carols, we're doing our annual carol singing at Tesco's this Thursday. And if you're free, it would be great to see. We have quite a small number. And so we could really do with some more. And the fact that Jim Phillips and Danny Rankin goes, that means that anybody can go. And so we really just want bodies. And if you're free, get a tong on Thursday night. Please come along. We'll come back afterwards for a wee bit of a ceilidh. Well, not really a ceilidh, but a cup of tea and a mince pie. And so if you're free, it would be great to see you at that. And the last announcement is that as you came in this morning, you received a wee blank piece of paper. The reason you've received that is what we want to do this year. We want to do something a wee bit different. We haven't done a yearbook for quite some time. And the Kirk Session thought, wouldn't it be great to do a yearbook this year, but we want to do something fancy. And so what we want to do is we want to make sure it's all up to date. And so we're asking you for your name and your address. We're all asking too that if you would like, if you would put a contact phone number, that's not compulsory. If you don't want to put a phone number, don't worry. And if you have an email, if you put it down, we would appreciate that. It means that this yearbook would be really handy to contact folk. But the big change for us is that we want to put every single person's photograph on it. So every member of the congregation, their photograph will be on that. And so I'll be taking a photograph over the next few weeks. And the reason we're doing that is it'll look really good if your photograph's on it. Well, for most of your photographs, it'll look really good. But actually, there's two reasons why we're doing it. The first reason is we're hoping that the yearbook will also be used for prayer. Do you know how sometimes when you're praying for folk, when you can visualize them in front of you, it's easier to pray for them? So I'd say that's why we want to do it. And the second reason is sometimes in our congregation, and we have some members who don't come out often because of illness or other reasons. And so therefore, if you're talking about somebody, for instance, if I'm talking to somebody and they say, I'm talking about Robert McGackie, and they'll say, who's Robert McGackie? I don't think I know him. And I said, well, he's the guy who's in the choir. And he said, oh, is that the guy who's in the choir who can't sing? I said, yes, that's him. Oh, yes, I know Robert McGackie. And sometimes what you have to do is you have to give a long explanation before you catch on who Robert McGackie is or whoever. Whereas if you have a yearbook with a photograph of Robert McGackie in the yearbook, then it would be really worth having. And so that's the idea too, so that it's easier for us to know who we all are, but it's also an opportunity for us to pray for one another. And so if you don't mind, over these next few weeks, we're going to ask for your photograph. And we'll also come to your house if some of your members are not out at church. And we'll ask to take their photograph. If you do not want your photograph taken, you don't need to get your photograph taken. So if you don't want your photograph in it at all, that's not a problem. We'll pressurize you a wee bit, but if you really don't want it, that's not a problem. I could understand why some folk wouldn't, and not want to mention any names, you know. But it would be really nice if we could get nearly everyone's photograph in it. It'll help us to pray, and it'll also help us to know exactly who everybody is. But if you can fill this in today, that'd be useful. And if you gave us one contact number, that would be lovely, because it'd be in the yearbook, and it meant if someone was wanting to phone you, it'd be easy for them to phone you, or if someone wants to contact you through email, then that would be quite easy for them to do that. Thank you so much.
Morning, everyone. Now I know why I was asked to stand out at the front over there this morning to get my photograph taken after that last announcement. But I thought it was a bit strange whenever he asked me, would I turn sideways to get my photograph taken? No, but it's nice to see you all here this morning, and big welcome to any visitors that we have with us, worshipping with us. It's nice to be back here again too, after a bit of an absence away from here. But I always said that I would come back, you know. I was only away for 2 weeks, so I came back anyway. Anyone after the morning service, you're all welcome to stay behind for a cup of tea or coffee and a bit of a chat afterwards. And look forward to seeing you there. So before we start our service this morning, let's bow our heads and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that we can come into your house here this morning. We thank you that we can come in your name to worship you. The psalmist wrote that he was glad and that he was happy when he came into your house. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that we will be just that way too. That the time spent here amongst us and listening to your word and the challenge of your word for today would be good for us. So, Heavenly Father, continue to be with us as we worship you. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is, this is the second Sunday in Advent. And we'll stick to the Advent theme. And we'll stand and sing with Charles Wesley's marvellous Advent hymns, Lo, He Comes with Clouds Descending.
Thank you.
thought just before Sam would pray, I want to show you a wee video. This is a video of the Christmas story as told by 8-year-olds.
Right, let's all bow our heads again. Let's pray again. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all your blessings and for all your mercies to us through the week that has passed. And we trust, Heavenly Father, that you will be with us through your Holy Spirit in the week that is to come. We thank you for bringing us together this morning in your name and pray that we, as we sing your praises and listen to your word and what your word has got to say to us today, we pray, Lord, that we will be challenged and that we will be strengthened to follow and to serve you. We thank you for this time of the Christian year, time of Advent, time when you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, into the world. We thank you, God, that you have planned this even before the world was created, that it was your plan to have man live in unity with you. But because of sin, man was separated from you and has continued to be separated from you down through the ages, despite your sending prophets asking them to repent of their sins. But your people continue to refuse to repent of their sins. And you call them a stiff-necked people. And they still refuse to repent when you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, into the world, because they put him to death on a cross. But we give you thanks today that your Son is alive in the world through your Holy Spirit, that he conquered sin and death and rose from the grave and now sits at your right hand, interceding for us. So, Heavenly Father, forgive us of our sins. Help us to be more and more like you. Help us to show love and compassion to those who still live in a sinful state and have no thought for you or what you have done for them. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that we can celebrate your first coming, and we look forward to when you will come again, this time not as the baby boy at Bethlehem, but as the ruler and the judge of all men, when you will finally separate those who will be in heaven with you and those who will be spending eternity in the darkness, separated from you for a final time. Lord, we continue to pray that you will be with us, and we ask you to be King of our lives. We thank you for that time when you came into our lives, and when you now rule our lives and you rule over us. And Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the children that are here this morning. We thank you for the gifts that we have received. And we pray, Lord, that they will be used in the distribution of those who are less wealthy or less off than us. We pray, Lord, for the children here as they gather now to hear the stories from the Scriptures. We pray that the seed of the gospel that will be sown into their young lives, and that one day they will accept you to be their Saviour and their friend. So, Heavenly Father, continue to be with us now. Continue to be with us as we sing your praises, as we listen to your word, and as we hear what your word has got to say to us today. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, boys and girls, if you'd like to leave us now, then we'll... and then we'll continue as in our second hymn. King of Kings, and we'll all stand and sing. Our reading this morning is taken from Matthew. Matthew chapter 1, and it's starting to read at verse 18. Coming up, yeah, there it is. Verse 18. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. And because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save the people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet: "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Amen. Let's again bow our heads and let's again pray. Heavenly Father, we again come to you in prayer, and we would just think of others, not only here in our congregation or in our district, but others throughout the world where there is hardship and where there is pain and sorrow. And Heavenly Father, we think of our own congregation at the moment. We pray, Lord, that you will be with Danny as he continues to keep in good health, as he continues to be with us here, ministering over us. We pray too, Lord, for our session on committee. We pray, Lord, too, that they will be committed. They will be committed to be able to rule over and look over and watch over the things that are necessary in this congregation. And we pray, Heavenly Father, for all our own members, those who are sick at this time, those who are sick at home, those who are in hospital, those who are in nursing homes. Lord, we pray that you will be with them, that you will minister to them this day, and that you will bring them to health and strength soon again. We pray, Lord, for those who have been bereaved, those who have lost a loved one or a dear friend. Lord, continue to be with them in their time of mourning. Be with them and be a shoulder to lean on. And we pray, Heavenly Father, for all our organizations, that they will continue, that they will be able to run smoothly, that they will be able to know you, and that the leaders will be able to instruct either the boys and girls or others of your truths and of who you are and what you have done for us. And we pray, Heavenly Father, for our own district here in Sydenham. We pray, Lord, that this church here will be used as a light, as a beacon, so that others might be drawn in. We know, Lord, that in the district of Sydenham today, there are those who just don't want to know you. There are those who have no time for you. There are those who don't believe in you. And so, Heavenly Father, we do pray and reach out, especially at this time of the year, that you will be with them, that in some way you will guide them, that you will guide them to come to you. We pray, Lord, for those in this area who are under some sort of hardship, whether it be financial or spiritual or mental. Lord, continue to be with them at this time. Continue to bless them and continue to help us to help them. And Lord, we pray for the wider world. We pray for those places in the world today, Lord, where there are wars and fighting. We think of Syria. We think of the town of Aleppo. Lord, we pray that the fighting will soon stop. We pray that aid will get through into these poor folks. We pray that food will get through, that medical aid will get through to alleviate the suffering of these people. And Lord, we do pray for Christians who are working in this area. We pray that you will be with them and strengthen them so that they may say a word for you to these people. And Lord, we pray for all those other areas of the world where there is famine, where the harvest is failed. Pray, Lord, that the people will be fed. We pray, Lord, that they will be able to be nourished. And Lord, we pray too that you will continue to bless your missionaries who are at work in all of these places. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to be with your missionaries and all over the world, those whom we know, those whom we have heard speaking here in this church. And Heavenly Father, continue to be with the doctors, the teachers, and the lecturers who are out in the mission field, helping others to come, so that they will be able to come to know you. So Heavenly Father, continue to be with us. Continue to bless us, for we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And then we'll continue, before Danny speaks to us, with Light of the World. Let's stand and sing.
If you've been looking at the preaching schedule, you know that over these next few weeks, we're beginning to look at Christmas, and this morning is Christmas is Born. What makes Christmas a special time of year? What makes the birth of Jesus particularly special. And in some ways, what we've done in the past, I know that I certainly done this, but we've focused on the wrong things. For instance, sometimes we think that what makes it special is the fact that poor Jesus was born in a stable. I mean, none of us know anybody who's ever born in a stable, and therefore that just shows you how awful it must have been for him or how humble he was. But actually, that's not particularly special. Because stables in those days are not stables of what we think nowadays. Stables we have are outside of where we live. And they tend to be fairly run down. They tend to be very basic. And they're not very hygienic. Stables in the time of Jesus were not like that. And in fact, stables were usually inside the house, the dwelling house of where the people lived. The folk used to live up above, and the stable was down below, and there wasn't much in between. It was like misery where they lived, to be honest. And the issue with of Jesus being born in the stable, when it says there's no room in the inn, really what was happening was he was going, if you like, along to various hotels or inns or their family were, and there was no rooms left, no paying rooms left. And all that was left was accommodation that was really quite basic. And it would have been something similar to being born in a two-up and two-down in Belfast. And so the basic working class person in Belfast was brought up in a two-up and two-down, and we know that many folk were brought up in that way. And there might have been 16 in the house or 8 in the house, and a wee kitchen house, we might call it. And so it was something quite small and nothing too fancy. But it was fine. What it did, if you were born and lived in a two-up, two-down, it usually meant that you came from a working-class background. That's really what it meant. And so being born in a stable in an inn was like being born in a two-up and two-down. Because most houses, most working-class houses at the time of Jesus had a stable inside the house. And so therefore, when they went to the various hotels, the various inns, because there was no fancy rooms left, there's no proper rooms left, what was left was like family accommodation that the family might have used for a poor person. And so therefore, that's what was offered to them. And so that wasn't that different from many, many people being born in Bethlehem or Nazareth or wherever at that time. And so Jesus being born in the stable wasn't particularly special. It wasn't particularly difficult. And it just showed you that Jesus was from a working class background. That's really what it meant to be born in the stable. And so that wasn't particularly special. The fact that his first visitors were shepherds, we think are really odd that that was the case. But again, that's not a particular case. I know a number of children that whenever they were born, that the first folk that visited them were shepherds. It so happened that was their surname, but that's beside the point. And so that's not particularly special that the shepherds happened to be the first. The point of that is really that shepherds were seen as outcasts. You know, if you had a dodgy job at the time of Jesus, then you would have been a shepherd. Shepherds were always out in the sheep looking after, out in the fields looking after their sheep. They were always out at night time, and so it was a bit dodgy to be out and about at night time. And so shepherds were seen as not the best profession. I can remember when I was at school, and if you misbehaved, the teacher would say, "Look, if you don't work, you'll end up brushing the streets. That's what you'll end up doing." And nowadays, that class is a really good job. And if only my teacher knew that brushing the streets is actually good pension, good sickness, all the rest of it, that's a great job nowadays. But in my day, that would have been seen as, you know, a shepherd would have been seen like that. If you're not careful, you'll end up being a shepherd. And really the point that the shepherds came at first to see Jesus was that God was saying that God was reaching out to everyone, even those that people don't think are particularly important. And so the fact that the shepherds came to see Jesus when he was born doesn't make Jesus special, doesn't make the whole idea of Christmas being special. So being in the stable isn't particularly special. Having visitors who were shepherds were not very special. We tend to think having three wise men come to visit you with gold, frankincense, and myrrh, that must have been special. But again, to be honest, when Prince William was born, he had a queen come and visit him, and he had princes and princesses coming to visit him. And so having someone important come to visit you when you're born isn't particularly special. It's more special than maybe other things, but not particularly special. This morning, just for a moment or two, I want to think of three reasons in this passage that makes Christmas special. When we think of the birth of Jesus, what makes it special? What makes it different from any other birth? It's not the stable, and it's not the shepherds, and it's not the wise men. The first thing we notice that makes it special is who his father is. That's what makes Jesus special. Mary and Joseph are engaged. Engagement nowadays is not that strong anymore. Oh, by the way, we, Steve, you got engaged last week. And we, Megan's a lovely wee girl. In case she watches us on YouTube, she's a lovely girl. Lovely girl. And although I did say to her, you've been going out with Steve in 2 years and you haven't come to Strand once. What sort of girlfriend are you? So I did say that to her. So if she ever comes, make sure you make her feel bad that you haven't seen her before. But anyway, so engagement in those days was very, very strong. Engagement was being married but not quite married yet. So you'd made the promise and that was it. Then he discovered that she was pregnant. And he was devastated. And the only thing he could do, because honor was very important. We don't, in the West, honor's not that important. We tend to say a good name is everything, but we don't really mean it. The reason why we don't really mean it, all you have to do is watch The Celebrity Get Me Out of Here. And you see there's some of the stupid things that people do just to be known. Or remember there used to be a program called Big Brother, and people would go into that and do the most degrading things just to be famous. And so honor's not particularly important in our society, but in Thai society, and particularly in Japanese society, honor is very, very important. And in the society where Jesus was born, honor was very important. And he discovered that his betrothed, the girl he was engaged to, was pregnant. And he didn't know what to do. What he should have done, what was the norm, was to divorce her publicly. And by divorcing her publicly, he was stating, she is pregnant and it's got nothing to do with me. I'm not the father. I'm not the one who's disgraced. She is the one who's disgraced. And it meant that his good name would be held and kept. Because by divorcing her publicly, he was declaring himself to be innocent. That's what he should have done. That's what would have been done. But he decided, actually, because he was a very gracious man, that he would divorce her quietly. In other words, he couldn't go through with the marriage because she was unfaithful. And he decided that he would do it quietly. And that meant that those who were in the inner circle would have known that he was innocent. But there's no smoke without fire, would have been the comment in the village or in the town. And so he was opening himself up for people to think, oh, something didn't go right there, and it could have been Joseph's fault. But he was allowing that to happen because he was a man of honour, and that's what he decided to do. And at that point then, he had a visitation from the angel, and the angel explained to him the situation. And this shows you the great faith that Joseph had, because Joseph then believed the angel and carried on. But I can assure you, in a society that honour is really important, his family, because this had never happened before, his family, his friends and society would have said, oh my goodness, look what has happened. And they would have been talking about it and talking about it. And Joseph could have talked to them till he was blue in the face. An angel spoke to me, they wouldn't have believed him. For Joseph, it would have been far better if the angel came to him and his family and the village and told everybody, look, this is what the situation is. But that wasn't the case. The angel only came to him. But he was willing to suffer disgrace because of his faith in God and his faith in Mary. But that tells us that the Father of Jesus is God and God alone. That's the first thing that makes Christmas special. A number of years ago, Dawn was born. Oh, a long time ago, Dawn was born. In fact,
I'm still in my 20s.
But only just. Dawn was born in Thailand, and the Thai hospital was really old-fashioned. And in those days, what it was is that they still took the child off the mother and took the child to the nursery. And they put them in these wee glass cots. And then what they would do is the father was not allowed near the child. So I couldn't see the child when I went up to visit Lorraine. Because whenever it was visiting time, they took the child, took Dawn away and put her in the nursery. So I came up and I visited Lorraine. And then I had to go down to the nursery, but I wasn't allowed in the nursery. Because when you went down to the nursery, they had this big window. And you could stand at the window and had all these wee cots up against the window. It was like a shop window. And you looked into your child, because there was a wee name, and that was your child. And you could see your child through the window. So there was a number of fathers, and I was standing there, and it was brown baby, brown baby, brown baby, white baby, brown baby, brown baby, brown baby, you see. And I'm standing with these other Thai guys, and the Thai guy turns around and says to me, "Which one's yours?" And I said, "What?" He says, "Which one's yours?" I said, "Tell you what, have a guess." You see, "Which one's mine?" It was obvious which one's mine. And the one who was crying, you know, that's, you know, that was the one that was mine. And then actually, shortly after that, we had decided that we'd send David to the local school. That wasn't really the done thing for missionaries, but we thought it would really help him and help us to integrate into society. So he went along to the local school, and at one Christmas time, they invited Lorraine and I to go along and talk about Christmas. What does Christmas mean, you see? So we went along, and there's about 300 children in the school, and they all wore this lovely blue and white uniform. And when they all sat, they were all sitting on the floor, and I was standing up to speak, and I was able to spot David a mile off. Because it was like, do you know how we have a box of matches? And every match in the box is lit and spent, but there's only one match that isn't lit and spent, you know, that red match. Then you can spot it a mile away. Well, there was a sea of black heads and one wee red head. It was easy to spot my child. He was the one with the red head and the red face, because it was beaming because it was so hot. So he was like every other child, but he was easy to spot because he was ours, because he had red hair. Dawn was easy to spot. There was 8 brown babies and 1 white baby. She was the same as all the others, but she was different. David was taught all the same things as the other boys and girls. He wore the exact same uniform as the boys and girls, but he was easy to spot because he was the same, but different. Jesus was a man, was a human like you and I, exactly like us, but he was different. Because his Father is God himself. That's the first thing that tells us that Christmas is worth celebrating. Because Jesus came to this earth. And because he is the same but different, then we can imagine that something different is going to happen with his life. And of course we know the story, and that is the case. The second thing that's different about Jesus is his name. And we're told that he's called Jesus. Now, in some ways, you might turn around and say, well, his name's not any different. You know, God told him to call him Jesus. Well, God told lots of people to call their sons or their daughters names. And, of course, Jesus is an Aramaic form of the Hebrew. And the Hebrew is Joshua. And, of course, we know there's a Joshua already in the Bible. So the name Jesus wasn't a special name in the sense that it had never been used before. But it was special in the sense that it exactly described what Jesus came to do. Because Jesus means God saves, Savior. He came to save his people from their sins. In fact, that's what he tells Joseph through the angel Gabriel. That's the purpose Jesus came. Now, we all tend to think that we've all got a purpose in life. And it's good if we all find our purpose. And some people say, well, I'm looking to find myself. When we lived in Thailand, there was always people coming to Thailand to find themselves. And they tended to get lost very easily. And we're always trying to find ourselves. And people say, well, you should find something that you're good at and then work at it. And lots of us live for years and we never really find ourselves and we never find what our purpose is in life. Although the Bible tells us the purpose for us is for us to have a relationship with God. And because of sin, that's no longer possible. But Jesus came in order to die so that that purpose in our lives might be fulfilled. That we might have that relationship. He saves us. What does he save us from? He saves us from ourselves. He saves us from sin. And he saves us from Satan. And so Jesus dies on the cross. And in dying on the cross, he conquers sin. He conquers Satan. And he conquers the consequences of sin, which is death itself. And that's why it is wonderful to celebrate Christmas. That's what makes Christmas special. Because Jesus came in order that we might find the true purpose in our life, which is to have a relationship with God. So it's special because Jesus' Father is God himself. It's special because of the purpose Jesus came. Jesus came to die for your sins and mine, so that we might find our true selves, and we find our true self in our relationship with God. And the third thing that makes Christmas special, again, is found in this passage, is that Jesus is given another name. A name that describes more than the fact that he comes to save. But he says, you're going to have a son, and he'll be called Emmanuel. Emmanuel. And he goes on to explain what that means. That means God with us. And so not only is God his Father, but he himself is God. And that's what makes Christmas not only special, but unique. Not only is God his Father, not only has he come to do a purpose to save us, but he is God himself. And the wonderful thing for that means that whenever we have him as our Lord and Savior, it tells us that through his Spirit, he lives within us. And that we have God with us at every moment, at every day. Do you know what it's like? Now, years ago, mobile phones were not that important. But they've become really important because your mobile phone does everything. In fact, they're called smartphones now. And I have a smartphone. And I always have it with me, which is actually useless. Because although I always have it with me, there's three problems with this phone. The first problem is, although I have it sometimes with me, I always will have it with me, I don't often answer it. And the reason is because sometimes I'm in a meeting or I'm in a place where I don't have reception and I can't answer it. So although I have it with me, sometimes I can't use it. The second problem I have with this phone is that although I sometimes have it with me, it's not charged up. In fact, my contract's up next April, and this phone's done. When I say it's done, it works perfectly well, except for the battery's rubbish in it. So I will charge it, and about 3 hours later, it's done again, and I have to keep remembering to charge it. So by the time about 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock, if I haven't charged it, it's just a piece of metal and glass in my pocket. It's no use to me. So sometimes it runs out of charge. So it works perfectly well, but it doesn't keep its charge. And the third problem with this phone is sometimes I take it with me. Although I say I always have it, always is a very loose word. I sometimes forget it, or sometimes I put it down. There was one day I had it in my pocket and I slipped in the back of this tea. And I couldn't find it. And so I said to Lorraine, would you phone my phone? And I could hear, you know how when you hear it ring? but you can't think what it was. And because I was in the living room, Lorraine phoned it. It was a sort of dull sound. I thought, it must be in the kitchen. So I hunted the kitchen. In fact, when I went to the kitchen, it was even duller. I thought, that's odd. I thought, oh, we're in the study. So I went in the study. And then I thought, it must be in another room. I couldn't imagine where it was, because when it was in the living room, although that was the strongest sound, it obviously sounded as if it wasn't in the living room. And it took me over an hour to realise it was in behind the sofa and in the seat. And talk about thick. And so, great phone, but sometimes I don't use it because I'm in a meeting or I don't have reception. Sometimes the battery runs out more often than now. That's what happens. And sometimes I lose it or I forget it. The great thing about Jesus is his name is Emmanuel, God with us. And the wonderful thing about having him as your Lord and Savior, he is always with us. Even at times when we find it hard to talk to him. We find it hard to talk to him sometimes because we're really busy. We sometimes find it hard to talk to him because we're sometimes worrying about other things. Sometimes when you worry, you find it hard to pray. And sometimes we find it hard to pray when we're unwell. I discovered that when I wasn't well, my concentration wasn't good. But even the times when I couldn't talk to him as the way I used to, because of various reasons, he was still with me. And he could still talk to me, even though I struggled to talk to him. Sometimes I get really tired. Sometimes I'm struggling, as we all do, isn't that right? Sometimes you're going to bed and you mean to pray and you fall asleep, or sometimes you mean to do that, but sometimes we're weak. We're not as strong as we used to be. Doesn't matter. Because God is always as strong as he is, because he lives within us. God is as strong in your life as he was when you were young, as he was whenever you first became a Christian. Because God is with you. It's not that we need to keep building the faith up to know that he's with us. He is with us because that's who he is. And you know, you can never, sometimes when we forget about God, sometimes we think, oh, I'm not as good as I should be. You know, I need to try harder. And sometimes we're not aware of God. Even in those times when we're not aware of God, God is with us because that's who he is. And that's the wonderful thing about Christmas. Jesus, God the Father, is his Father. Jesus, he came with a purpose, and that purpose was to make sure that you were fulfilled completely in your relationship with God. Jesus, called God is with him. God is with us. So when he's in your heart, no matter how you feel, he is with you in all his power, in all his grace, all his might, and all his mercy. And one of the wonderful verses, I think is wonderful, when Paul is talking to the church, he says, you know, the Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead, and that was absolutely wonderful, is the same Spirit that's in you. In other words, don't ever doubt that God is with you. Because the God that we read about in the Bible, who was born in a stable, and that's no big deal, who had shepherds come and visit him, that's really no big deal. Had three wise men travelled a big distance and gave them lovely gifts, no big deal. But the Jesus, whose Father is God, whose purpose in his life was to redeem you and to save you, who promises never to leave you nor forsake you, he's the one who was born at Christmas. Let's pray. Father God, we come before you and we thank you for Christmas. We thank you it's all about the birth of Jesus. And we can enjoy all the trimmings of what that means. The trimmings might be the stable and the wise men and the shepherds. The trimmings might be the turkey and the gifts and the family. Those are all lovely trimmings that we enjoy. But help us to remember the core of Christmas. And the core of Christmas is the birth of Jesus. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship God with our offerings. I forgot to explain what you did with the slips of paper. So whenever you fill in your slip of paper, give it to Robert McGackie or Danny Rankin. You can see the shock in his face there. See that there? Give it to Robert McGackie or Danny Rankin. And we'd appreciate that. That'd be kind. Hark the glad sound, the Saviour comes. Let's stand to worship. And by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest and reign with each one of us now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.